evening again.
It's okay. I'm sure you will have other P talks to give. So
after I have other papers.
Yeah. So maybe let's don't wait any longer. Let's begin. Today we are really happy to have our own Andre to give us a special FTPI seminar. Okay. That about black hole induced the false vacuum decays from first principle.
Right. Thank you for having me here. Yeah, I'll talk about recent research made in collaboration with Sergei Sibirokov from Perimeter based on these two papers. That's nice. And no, something's wrong. Ah, okay. Yeah. Okay, so let's start from some motivation. Why is it interesting to study vacuum decay in field theory? Well, part of the motivation, as we know, it comes from phenomenology because it may have something to do with the fundamental physics of the real world. Namely, if you take the standard model and consider Higgs potential, then we know that at tree level, the potential behaves just like that. So our electric vacuum is a absolute minimum of this potential. Yeah, let's neglect the Higgs mass for the moment. It's not important. But once we take into account radiative corrections to this potential, then its behavior can be drastically different at high energy scales. And in particular, it can even become negative at this high energy scales, which means that our minimum is not an absolute minimum of the potential anymore. That there is this deep second region, and in principle, it is possible to somehow to have phase transition from this minimum to that minimum, which means that our vacuum is not absolutely stable. And so the typical values are like 10 to 10, 10 to 11 GeV if you use the standard model, make computations in the standard model. And of course, if you allow also new physics, this can also change this result. Now, so we have this result, and then of course there have been a lot of studies dedicated to this problem, where and the lifetime of our vacuum is very well known, and the general conclusion is that in the present day universe, at low energies, low temperatures, and homogeneous background, the lifetime is very big, so we are safe.
So just for my education, right? We know standard model Higgs potential, the self-coupling turns negative, right? And so when we calculate the matter stability of our standard model universe, do I need to know what's the potential, how the potential behave at extremely high scale, right? It turns negative, and what's afterwards, right?
Well, okay.
Can we go deeper, or then there's another. And there's an additional term. Do I need to assume it's bounded from below due to new physics or not?
In principle, you can just compute it. And in principle, if you don't want any new physics, you can compute it up until Planck energies, right? And in principle, and then you can use this potential, and then you can compute the tunneling solution, the bound solution, this potential. And then the question is, what's the characteristic scale, energy scale of the tunneling solution, right? Which value it hits, right? And then up until this value, you should know your potential, how it behaves. What happens after this value is not so important. The result is that if you take the standard model fixed potential, the general result is that the field value, the magnitude of the field at the center of this bound solution, it is around the minimum of the quartic coupling. Which means, and the minimum of the quartic coupling happens close enough to the Planck value, with this, if you use like central values or some small parameters and so on. So the bounce is very energetic.
Yeah.
And therefore, in principle, of course, it is sensitive. In particular, it is sensitive to possible operators that you add to the Lagrangian of the standard model, which is suppressed by Planck. This can affect this result. So yeah,
basically, you can get any result because, right?
And then in principle, you can get any result. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this was a paper by Mark Scher, and then well, there was also a paper recently earlier this year.
There are papers by Branchino, for example.
Yeah, that was saying that all these calculations in the standard model of the lifetime, that they're irrelevant because you want to add in the Planck suppressed operators right, and you get any value you want.
But you were asking if you don't add anything in.
Yeah, if I don't add
then there's no minimum, right? Then
right, there's no minimum. So how can I calculate the lifetime or the bounce action doesn't depend on?
No, in look, even there is, you see, it doesn't necessarily, so the bounce, it doesn't necessarily hit the absolute minimum of the potential.
Sure,
right?
Sure. But so, by so how it, far it extends to, right? The typical scale extends to.
The typical scale, yeah. So the typical scale, it's actually easy to understand. So you can, if you have,
I understand what you were saying earlier. So
yeah.
To draw the plot.
So if you have this potential, right? Okay. So there is this result that in this potential, like m squared phi squared lambda phi to the fourth, in four dimensions, there is no tunneling solution of this finite size. Okay. So that's an interesting result. So to have solution, you should change somehow the potential. And if you change it like that, then it is kind of expected that the characteristic scale of the solution, it is associated with the scale at which you start feeling this modification of the potential. You cannot apply it like directly to the Higgs potential, right? Because this is due to radiative corrections, right? So it's not like you add g phi to six power, for example, right? It's there are logarithms here, but the idea is the same, which means that it probes the values which are around the bottom of this potential, and this bottom is somehow close to the Planck value. Yeah, that's what happens in the standard model.
When you say you can get anything you want, like adding Planck's suppressed operator, don't I get more and more stable instead? So
No. That depends, right? That depends on the sign. That depends. Yeah.
Depends on the sign. If it's inactive, I cannot even perform such a calculation to calculate a lifetime, right? Or what else? Do I need to do something else to?
What do you mean? If you add some Planck suppressed operator, then it will turn around the potential. And then you get that picture, right?
Right. However, the vacuum still be metastable, right? So this Planck suppressor operators, they cannot change the behavior of the potential here where it becomes negative. So in principle, the result is of course sensitive, but the very fact that it is unstable, that's I would say is robust, right?
It's unstable, it's robust.
Yeah.
Whether it's, what's the lifetime, right? What, how metastable it is.
That itself is, I would say, yeah.
Because it's usually sold that we live near a critical line. That's normally sold as papers of Giudici and Strumia.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's near criticality. And,
that might be true. We could be far from the line.
That's right.
That's what's possible. Yeah.
No, but even within I don't know 2 sigma band of the standard model parameters, there's still many things are possible here.
But you can always add something that's below Planck suppressed, right? So
and if you allow new physics, then anything
right. Once you put in new physics, you know, put in supersymmetry, and this never happens at all, right? Because the quartic is positive definite.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so there's been a lot of activity here, and this is a very incomplete list of papers studying this question, and so the stability of electric vacuum in the standard model. It hasn't studied at various setups, well, not only in the standard model, but also in its modifications, as we just discussed, and in flat space time, with the gravitational corrections taken into account, also in thermal bath, so when you have finite temperature, how it can change the prediction, and also in some other epochs of our universe, like during inflation, for example, and also for vacuum decay, has been studied in the presence of local space-time homogeneities such as black holes. Okay, so what's so special about black holes? That's actually a very general expectation, right? If you drop impurity into homogeneous medium, then Then actually that's a very general expectation, right? That impurity exceeds phase transition. So apparently black holes can do the same. That's a very general expectation. So what's so special about black holes here? Well, there are two things. The first thing is that that's a space-time inhomogeneity. And it's a fairly simple space-time inhomogeneity. So you can study it and sometimes even analytically, especially if you use some simplified some toy models. If you go to two dimensions, for example, many results can be obtained analytically. This is one interesting fact about black holes. And another interesting fact is that it's not only source of curved space-time, but it's also source of thermal radiation, thanks to the properties of, thanks to the fact that there is a horizon. You have non-trivial quantum vacuum, which manifests itself as Hawking radiation from the point of view of an outside observer. And in principle, because of this, to really answer the question how black hole catalyzes vacuum decay, you should understand not only how curved spacetime affects the decay rate, but also how this source of thermal radiation or almost thermal radiation affects vacuum decay. And notice here that even if here the radiation is thermal, the system, the overall system is not in thermal equilibrium, right? Because its source, which is an empty space, which radiates, radiation moves away. And the question is how the system catalyzes vacuum decay is interesting by itself. So this, the two effects can actually be equally important, right? Because they have the common source. So this problem of catalysis of vacuum decay by black holes is not new, and there is quite a number of papers dedicated to it. But recently, the interest has been renewed. The motivation here is the following. So there are models predicting, for example, small primordial black holes in our universe that could exist in the early universe and can be completely evaporated by now. And for such small primordial black holes, we know that the smaller the black hole is, the hotter the temperature of Hawking radiation, roughly speaking, right? So for such small primordial black holes, you would expect that its immediate vicinity is surrounded by gas of extremely hot radiation, right? Hot particles, Hawking particles. Now, and in principle, when black hole evaporates, it scans all possible temperatures, well, up to the Planckian temperature, presumably up to those values. Therefore, at some point, the naive expectation is that these fluctuations of quantum fields near the black hole, they become so violent that they just throw your system over the potential barrier separating the true and false vacuum. And within this logic, it seems that this happens almost inevitably. Right, so whenever you reach such a critical, some critical energy or critical temperature or critical size of the black hole, you have this order one probability of vacuum decay, phase transition. And if you try to apply this logic to the standard model Higgs potential, then you arrive at quite strong conclusion that either there are no such light primordial black holes at all, at least in our causal past, or the Higgs potential behaves in a way that actually makes the electric vacuum stable, or at least much, that stabilizes basically the electric vacuum. Otherwise, that's disaster. So, and this is one more the recent motivation to study this black hole catalysis of vacuum decay. And but of course, there is also motivation from the point of view of theory, because black holes are interesting theoretical objects, and there are some interesting questions related to black hole physics, right? Because it's a non-perturbative gravitational physics, and there are puzzles associated with black holes, black hole entropy, informational paradox, and on the other hand, this vacuum decay, the tunneling, This is also, by definition, it's all non-perturbative process. So here we kind of study non-perturbative gravitational physics, semi-classical gravity. So maybe all the things are somehow related to each other in a nice way. And by studying how black holes catalyze vacuum decay, we may learn something about these puzzles. So that's why it's also interesting to ask such questions. But then, if you want to address this problem, okay, so there are several specific questions that one can ask here, and one should know how to answer them, right? And this question, which do not arise when you study vacuum decay just in flat space time, where I mean everything is known, there is known prescription how to compute the tunneling solutions and so on. So in the presence of black holes, it's not so obvious. So one thing which is not obvious is that because of the presence of horizon, in principle, it should be able to formulate the vacuum decay problem in such a way that only the region outside the black hole is relevant, right? So it shouldn't matter what happens beyond the horizon, right? So how to make sure of it, right? How to see this explicitly that it doesn't matter? That's first question. Second question is, since we have this curved space time, we can use many coordinate systems, right? We don't have preferable coordinate system like Cartesian coordinates in Minkowski space time. And since the decay rate of false vacuum is a coordinate independent quantity, in principle, we should be able to arrive at the same result. But still, the question is which coordinates are most convenient. Okay. The next question is okay, so since we talk about vacuum decay here, it would be good to understand what vacuum states are possible, right? What vacuum states are associated with black holes. And the important thing here is that vacuum is defined not only by classical expectation values of fields, but also by state of quantum fluctuations around those values, right? And it could be that with the same classical vacuum, the classical vacuum is the same, the classical ground state is the same, but different states of quantum fluctuations define different vacuum states. And for them, for these different states, the decay probability can be different, as we'll see later. Actually, parametrically different, so very different. And the last question, but perhaps the most interesting question here is that, okay, so the standard theory of vacuum decay tells us that one should look for a solution, classical solution of equations of motion in Euclidean time, for example. And the solution must obey certain boundary conditions, right? This is a way to select a unique solution of the equations of motion out of all possible solutions. You should select a unique one, right? And it is selected by choosing appropriate boundary conditions. So the question is how to choose appropriate boundary conditions corresponding to a given state of vacuum around black hole. So how these two things are related to each other, okay? And okay, let's answer all these questions.
Can I go back one page about the third question? What's the vacuum state characterizing the black hole? I thought to calculate this tunneling thing, you only care about the region outside the black, outside the horizon.
Yeah.
So you still need to define the-
right? Yes. Well, we'll see later, but in principle, yeah. Because it depends, you see, you can use exactly because you don't have a preferred coordinate system, right? You can use different coordinates to define different sets of modes, right? And then you define a vacuum state with respect to different sets of modes, you get different vacuum states. Then, then you should find some physical interpretation for each of these vacuum states.
This is just because you're doing this now in a curved background.
Yes. And because you have horizon, so basically the ultimate reason is that you have horizon. And because of that, you have this uncertainty and you can choose different vacuum states. But the important point is that, of course, there should be some physical interpretation behind it, right? And the physical interpretation is that we want to speak about some realistic black hole, and the realistic black hole is a black hole that was once formed due to collapse of matter, right? And you want to find the vacuum state which corresponds to this physical situation. When you have an evaporating black hole, which was once formed, which is not eternal therefore, which will once evaporate, And we want to see what vacuum state is associated with this black hole and how vacuum decay proceeds from this particular state. So that's a physical question here.
But the wording is that you're going to induce a transition in the Higgs potential.
Yes.
And that will just grow essentially at the speed of light and eventually encompass everything. Is that?
Well, we don't consider back reaction if you're asking about this.
Well, either back reaction or I guess at some point you need to worry about the density of these bubbles, right? How often does this happen?
Ah, no, that's true. Okay, yeah.
If it happened once, maybe it's still far away and that bubble wall is coming towards us.
Sure.
And it's coming at the speed of light, and okay.
No, that's why I said that the worst case scenario, right? There shouldn't be a single light promoted black hole now causal past. Right? That's of course it may happen somewhere, and yeah, I agree.
So you can also ask the question: do these things percolate, and do you get
that's also a question.
And then I guess now the geometry. So you create this bubble, the black hole now becomes inside this bubble.
Uh-huh.
So you get some sort of Schwarzschild anti-de Sitter solution, right?
Well, that's why I said that we don't consider back reactions. So the problem is actually quite challenging by itself. So the first step here is to fix the gravitational background, to fix it completely.
Well, outside the bubble, you know what's going on. It's just everything normal and you have this bubble.
Yeah,
inside the bubble, right, you're effectively anti-de Sitter.
It's let it be anti-de Sitter, but
black hole.
Yeah. But
those solutions must be known, right? I mean, the Sitter with a black hole is certainly known.
They are all known, but this doesn't tell us anything about what is the appropriate tunneling solution, right?
No, because it's after tunneling has occurred. So the tunneling has occurred. Now you have inside this bubble, a Schwarzschild.
No, then you know everything. Yeah, then you just continue to real time and you just see how it evolves.
Yeah. ADS black hole.
Yeah. The question is to arrive at this critical bubble, right? So after you compute the bubble, in principle, you know everything. Yeah. Right. But okay, so related interesting question here is that of course we are talking here about exponentially suppressed events, right? And then one may ask the question, how it is related to the fact that the black hole itself has a finite lifetime, right? Because in principle, the time of operational black hole is power law, right? So it's the time of vacuum decay, the average time of vacuum decay is exponentially suppressed. So maybe there'll be no event of triggering vacuum decay around a single black hole. But then, of course, you should have an ensemble of black holes, right? And then on average, so that's how one should interpret this. All right. So yeah, let's be as simple as possible, right? Let's go to 1+1 dimensions. As I just said, let's neglect completely back reaction on the ground geometry. So we'll be working in a fixed geometry of a two-dimensional black hole. And let's choose the simplest possible tunneling system, just a real scalar field and a stable potential, which looks schematically like this. Here we can even allow the true vacuum to be at phi going to plus infinity. So it's runaway, it's not really important, at least for two dimensions. And in two dimensions, we can write the metric in this form. So kind of tortoise coordinates. So omega here is conformal factor, which goes to one at large x, right? So the metric is asymptotically flat. And when x goes to minus infinity, it behaves like this. So x equals minus infinity is horizon. And near horizon, it behaves like this. That's a general fact. And with this choice of the conformal factor, this is a Rindberg metric. So this just reflects the fact that close to the horizon, the geometry is approximated by the Rindberg spacetime. The Rindberg spacetime is a spacetime. It is a Minkowski spacetime from the point of view of uniformly accelerating observer. And this turns out to be very important for all our calculations and for our understanding of what happens with vacuum decay around black holes. So this coordinates T and X, they cover this physical wedge, so to speak, of this space-time diagram. And we'll be only interested in this physical wedge, right? So we, in what follows, we will not need anything, any information about what happens here, provided, of course, that we know what boundary conditions are imposed by the false vacuum state. And these boundary conditions are imposed here and here, so in the remote past, right? Both on the past horizon and past asymptotic infinity. Okay, so then we introduce this parameter lambda, which is related by to the black hole temperature in this way. And also, as I said, we neglect the change of the metric field due to black hole evaporation. So the metric is static. And also, we do not consider highly non-stationary moments of black hole formation and black hole complete evaporation. In principle, these events, so these are like very energetic events, right? So in principle, each of them can also trigger vacuum decay, can significantly enhance the probability of vacuum decay. However, these are only single events, right? While the black hole, it exists during very long time and during which time you accumulate this probability. So that's what we're interested in.
So here you're in Minkowski, not in
3D. Well, so that's the metric is in this form, right? Where omega, it has this property. So it's conformally flat.
But your action is Minkowski, right?
No, there is a G here.
Yeah, minus G.
Yeah. Yeah. No, right. So that's Lorentzian signature. That's what I want. That's a Lorentzian signature.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So far it is Lorentzian signature.
You're not going to be finding a Euclidean.
No, because we're going to be more general than that. Because Euclidean bounds, you see Euclidean time formalism, that's prescription. And we'll see that you can derive this prescription, but you should work in more general formalism. For the Unruh vacuum, which is like the physically interesting case, there is no, you cannot use this Euclidean prescription. So we work with Lorentzian time.
I see, so you work in Lorentz.
Yeah. Well, generally speaking, we work in complex time. I will explain later. So this T is a complex variable. Okay. So finally, we have the tunneling system. This real scalar field is denoted by phi, and this is the action for it. So G is a small coupling constant which controls semi-classical expansion, and just very standard action. All right. Yeah. Let's discuss vacuum states around black holes. So in two dimensions, we can just write this expression for the quantum field, right? So we introduce creation annihilation operators. We introduce left moving and right moving modes, which move either towards the horizon or away from the horizon. And using this set of modes, we can introduce the following vacuum states. So the first vacuum state that we can study is a so-called Boulevard vacuum. In the Boulevard vacuum, with respect to this particular set of creation and regulation operator, so the vacuum is defined like that, right? So it is defined as a state which is empty of both left and right moving modes. Physically, the modes which are defined like that, they're singular, both at the past and future horizon. So the Boulevard vacuum is singular. Therefore, it is not really a physical vacuum. You cannot give it a physical interpretation if you have a black hole because of the singularity of the horizon. However, you can try to interpret it in the following way. Suppose instead of black hole, you have a black hole mimicker. You have some configuration which is close to the black hole, but which is nevertheless regular, which doesn't have horizon. Okay? For this configuration without the horizon, you can actually argue that the corresponding vacuum state is well approximated by the Boulevard vacuum. So this just tells you that there is no radiation, neither Hawking radiation nor any other radiation. So it's just empty space and some compact objects in this empty space. So like brown dwarf. So that's one state. Another state is a Hartree-Hawking vacuum. That's the opposite situation. In the Hartley-Hawkins state, both right and left moving modes are thermally populated. So physically, that's very clear what it is. It's a black hole in thermal equilibrium. Okay, so you have a black hole which has certain temperature, and you place it into the thermal bath with the same temperature. So you have both right moving modes, which represents Hawking radiation, and you have left moving modes, which represent modes which fly from asymptotic infinity. Okay, and finally, the most interesting case physically, that's a so-called Unruh vacuum. So in the Unruh vacuum, right moving modes are still thermally populated. That's Hawking radiation, okay? But left moving modes are empty. So there is nothing falling in. So that's a black hole, that's a radiating black hole in empty space. That's an Unruh vacuum. And as was shown by Unruh in this paper, that's basically the state which corresponds to the black hole that is formed once and then exists and evaporates. And these are the modes. Okay, so these two states, they are equilibrium states, right? So here, this is just vacuum and this is thermal equilibrium. For these two states, it is known how to compute vacuum decay. There is no prescription, how to look for tunneling solution. For this state, there is no such ready to use prescription. You don't know what to do because this state is not in equilibrium of any kind. So you cannot just go to Euclidean time, for example. That's not justified. However, even without any explicit computation, one can guess how the decay rates from these three vacuum states are arranged, right? Since you have Hartley-Hawking state is the most energetic state, right? Because it contains both left and right moving modes, you would expect that the decay rate is the highest for the Hartley-Hawking state. The probability of decay is the highest for the state, because any excitation catalyzes vacuum decay. That's a general expectation. For the Unruh state, it is lower. And for the Bulwar state, it is the lowest because there are no excitations at all. And of course, this conclusion, it has been made in the literature and one can see it. So in principle, that's a known statement. This is a guess, but this is a guess. Right. Now, to make a real computation, we should really go back to the roots and see how to proceed, right? So very generally, what we consider transition amplitude from initial state to final state. The initial state is associated with a false vacuum, and final state is somewhere in the true vacuum region, in the basin of attraction of true vacuum, so to speak. And to find the decay probability, we just square and sum over all final states which belongs to this true vacuum region. We do not know which state is the exact state, but we don't need to know. We sum over all appropriate states, okay? Then to calculate this amplitude, we just write the path integral expression for this amplitude, right? We just introduce eigenstates of the field operator, we project, we sum with this weight, and we introduce these boundary conditions for the field. So this is just the standard expression that you can write, the path integral representation of transition amplitude. Then you take the square and you sum and you arrive at this expression. So yeah, let me explain. So in this expression, this field phi c, it runs along this contour in the complex time plane, okay? So these black lines are singularities of the bound solution I will explain later. But for example, if you consider this amplitude, right? For this amplitude, the field phi, it lives on this part of the contour in the complex time plane. So it runs from t initial, this is one boundary condition, runs from some t initial to some t final. Okay, so it lives on this part of the contour. When we consider the complex conjugated amplitude, we obtain another part of the contour and the field which now runs from t final to t initial. But this is a complex conjugated part of the contour. So when we consider the full expression, the square of the amplitude, we can think of it, we can think of this field phi c as living on this combined contour, which runs in complex time plane. Why we use a complex time plane? Because we have to do that. Because we have to satisfy the boundary conditions for the tunneling solution, okay? And we have to bypass all possible singularities of the tunneling solution. So that's actually, there is nothing special about this expression. This is a very general expression. This is a so-called informalism. Because you see here the field, it runs from some initial moment of time back again to the initial moment of time, the full contour. And you can use this informalism to compute many things. It was done, for example, in this paper. And it was applied also to the vacuum decay computations when people tried to argue, for example, that, tried to prove that decay probability is a gauge independent quantity, which is important in a standard model. You have to show that it is gauge independent. And they're also using this kind of formalism. So there is really nothing special about this formula. These are just general formulas. And but what is important to understand here is so the initial state here is a false vacuum state, right? Which is a quantum vacuum. And since this initial state, from the point of view of an outside observer, it is a mixed state. It is not a pure state. Therefore, we should just modify this expression slightly. So instead of the product of two initial states, we introduce the initial state density matrix. Since we work in the black hole exterior, and in this exterior region, our vacuum states are mixed states. So we introduce this density matrix.
Wait, just to make sure. So is the metric also included in this measure or not?
That's a good question. Of course, this expression is not like mathematically, yeah. Let's say that the measure is included into this science D, okay? And in principle, of course, the measure should be included here. The measure, however, affects, that's also like a general expectation, right? You should really be careful about the measure if you want to compute the prefactor to your expression. Here we don't want to compute the prefactor yet. I will comment on that this is actually important, and one should understand of course zero modes and all this stuff. However, as soon as we are interested only in the main exponential contribution, we can afford to be slightly not completely accurate writing down these expressions. So we should understand the tunneling solution. We should understand the boundary conditions for the tunneling solution, which actually come from this matrix element. And we don't have to be 100% accurate about, you know, the measure and so on. But
I guess if you want to compute a prefactor, then you have to do the renormalization and so on. And
in particular, of course, that's just one effect that you have to take into account, right? You have to, the renormalization in particular. Also, if you work in thermal bus, you have to take into account thermal corrections, your potential, and so on. But you see, in our case, we don't have thermal bus, but we are sort of half thermal bus, right? We have left modes, we don't have right modes. And if you want to compute thermal corrections to the potential, the question is, are they really thermal corrections? Right? So these are all very interesting questions. And I believe there is a general formalism like 2pi effective action or whatever that in principle allows you to, you know, to systematically derive order by order, your quantities or like decay rates or whatever you want to compute, order by order in perturbation theory. But yeah, okay, so here we are much more modest. We're just asking the simplest, you're trying to answer the simplest question here. All right, so now we evaluate this expression in the saddle point approximation, right? So we use the fact that we have the semi-classical parameter, which is much smaller than one, and we look for the saddle point, for the appropriate saddle point of this expression. And this saddle point configuration is called bounds. And let's discuss its properties. So bounds is a solution of classical equations of motion. Again, there are subtleties here, but let's just say that it is a solution of classical equations of motion, which is written here. And it lives on this contour C, as I explained, in the complex time plane. And we assume that the bound solution is unique. Therefore, its values on the upper and lower parts of the contour complex conjugate. As a consequence, here it is real. So from this point, it can be continued to real time, where it describes the actual evolution of the field after tunneling. So these black lines are singularities of the bound solution, and they should be avoided on the contour. It should not intersect any singularities. So here, the singularities are located on the real time axis. This happens if the tunneling potential is unbounded from below, like in this toy model that I will explain later. This basically just means that true vacuum is reached in a finite amount of time, but it doesn't really matter. So if you choose a potential which is bounded from below, like this one, it will shift this branch cuts to the complex plane. And then and then you will have two complex conjugate branch cuts, and then you will draw this contour such that it encompasses these two branch cuts. And basically, that's it. So conceptually, it's all the same. Okay, the most important property of the bound solution is that it must linearize in this limit when t goes to t initial up and low, right? Because in this limit, it should approach a false vacuum state, but it should approach not just any false vacuum state, but the correct one, the one that we want. And the question is, what are the boundary conditions corresponding to this false vacuum state? And well, the long story short, these boundary conditions are the same as for the time ordered Green's function in the corresponding vacuum, let's call it X. So let's define the Green's function as a time ordered average of this form, and it satisfies this equation of motion. And okay, so it turns out that these Green's functions, they play a crucial role in the whole analysis. So let's just see how it happens. So let's go back to the equation of motion for the field. So this is a general equation of motion. So phi here is a general solution of this equation, right? Then if you have a Green's function, not the particular Green's function, but any Green's function, we can write this equation just in this integral form, right? Just an equivalent form. This is now the integral equation for this general solution phi. So the statement is that to select a particular solution, the bounds solution, one should first adopt the time integration contour, as I explained before. And second, one should choose a particular Green's function, namely the time ordered Green's function. And the time, this Green's function is different for the three vacuum states that we considered. Therefore, the solution is different. Therefore, the decay rate is different, as we will see. And so that's basically it. That's like the main result. And then to compute the decay rate, we just use this simple estimate. We don't care about the prefactor, at least not so far. And then the decay rate is just given by this expression, where B, exponential suppression, is just the action of the theory computed on the bounds configuration up to some boundary terms. And so this is the general story. The next question is, can we actually use it? Can we actually compute something, right? So can we make a real computation? And before that, let's just have a look at this Green's function, because they're very important. So just a few words, right? So let's look again at this field operator. We introduce positive and negative frequency modes. And for this, we introduce left and right moving modes, which are complete set of modes. And for this modes, the equation of motion reduces to this equation, which is kind of Schrodinger equation. And this conformal factor is a potential for the Schrodinger equation, and it looks like this, right? So this is a symplectic infinity, asymptotically flat spacetime here, and this is the near horizon region, right, where this conformal factor is e to the power of 2 lambda x. And this is a transition region which happens around x equals 0. And this is our effective potential for modes. And this is how we define left and right moving modes, right? So these modes become left moving when in the near horizon region, and these modes become right moving in the asymptotically flat region. And using these modes, we can straightforwardly compute all Green's functions of interest. And for the Boulevard and Hartley-Hawking Green's function, we don't see any, they look as expected, right? So this is a general expression for the vacuum Green's function. If it's a Minkowski space, it's just a Feynman's Green's function. So there is nothing special about it. In curved spacetime, it's more complicated, but the general expression is identical. That's a vacuum Green's function, as you expect for the Boulevard state, which doesn't contain any field excitations. For the Hartley-Hawking Green's function, you again obtain the familiar expression. This is a thermal Green's function. Again, in flat space, it's just a thermal Green's function. In curved space, it's something more complicated, but the general expression is identical, which kind of tells you once again that the Hartley-Hawking vacuum from the point of view of an outside observer is a thermal state. So again, nothing out of the ordinary here. Now, how does the UNU function look like, right? So you would expect that it is somewhere in between the Boulevard and the Hartley-Hawking Green's function, right? So left modes are in vacuum, right modes are in thermal equilibrium, right? So you would expect it to be sort of linear superposition of the two Green's functions. This is true, but this is not completely true. So this is how it looks like in two dimensions for a massive scalar field. Also kind of new expression. It was new to us as far as I know. So what's so interesting so about this expression? Indeed, we have sort of right piece for the right modes. We have the vacuum piece for the left modes. But then we also have this complicated expression, which contains explicitly the reflection transmission amplitude of this effective potential, right? And this piece is just reflects a gray body factor. It just reflects the fact that these modes, they interact with the potential, they get reflected, they get transmitted. You have some complicated dynamics here. And therefore, the Unruh-Green's function is not a simple superposition of left and right, of vacuum left and thermal right Green's functions. There is also this term that mixes left and right moving modes. Okay, so that's a general expression for the Unruh-Green's function. And now let's make some real computation. So let's look again at this integral equation of motion for the bound solution. And well, in general, one can just try to solve this equation numerically, right? Because everything is known. The Green's function is known. However, that's very complicated because the solution lives on this contour in Euclidean in complex time plane. So that's a integral equation of, or if you cast, if you rewrite it as a differential equation, that's going to be a differential equation of the mixed type, right? Half partially elliptical, partially hyperbolic. So that's very complicated to solve numerically. So let's think of some bypass. So can we really use some trick here and simplify our computation? So simplification happens if we assume that the bound solution looks like this. If you assume that the bound solution, it has a nonlinear core, where it probes the true vacuum region, but this core is very, very narrow, okay? So there is a scale associated with the core of the solution, and it is very, very small, the length scale. And we have a linear tail, which is associated with the Compton wavelengths of the field, but it is much, much broader than this core, okay? So if the bound solution has this structure, then we can simply neglect, in this equation, we can simply neglect this term, we can approximate it by the delta function. Because when you look at this core from far away, you don't see its structure. You see it as a point-like object, right? So you just substitute here in this region. You just substitute here the delta function, and then you find that in this region, in the outer region, the bound solution is simply proportional to the Green's function. That's it. That's it. Which as it should be. Right. However, you see, you have to know how the solution looks here. So you have to compute it here as well, right? So then ideally, the ideal situation is the following. You have certain domains. You have the inner region and the outer region. And in the inner region, you can neglect the mass term completely because the nonlinearity is dominant. And in the outer region, you can neglect the nonlinearity because it's negligibly small and you have the linear equation of motion. Hopefully, there will be also some overlap region where both terms can be neglected, and that's just the linear, some linear function, right? The solution is some linear function. So neither mass nor the potential are important here. And in this region, you match the solution, the parts of the solution found in these two regions. And this is how you recover the full solution. So this is our strategy of finding the tunneling solution. And then we actually found the model in which the bounds has the structure. So this is just the mass term. This is the tunneling potential of the field phi, the usual mass term. And this is a so-called Liouville potential, okay? So the potential looks like this. It is approximately quadratic up to some scale phi max, and then it rapidly drops down, and then there is a true vacuum region here. So thanks to these properties of this tunneling potential, we can actually solve analytically the equation of motion in the inner region, because when we get the mass term, the equation of motion becomes a Liouville equation, and it is exactly solvable. We know the general solution analytically. On the other hand, in the outer region, we neglect this part. Yeah, so this is our black hole metric. So we use a so-called dilaton two-dimensional black hole, whose analytical solution is also known. So this is our explicit form of the conformal factor. And again, this is choice of the conformal factor. And when we neglect the nonlinear term here, we can find all Green's functions. So we can find the solution here in the outer region also analytically, because we can find all Green's functions analytically. We can find them analytically both in the near horizon region, where the space-time is approximately Rindler. And this is where the Rindler metric becomes important, because in the Rindler space-time, it turns out that you can also solve everything analytically. And you can solve everything analytically in the asymptotically flat region, where the metric is asymptotically is approximately Minkowski metric. Okay, in the transition region, you cannot solve analytically, but then you can sort of match the two regimes, and you can guess what happens in this region as well. So in other words, with this choice of the potential and this choice of the black hole metric, everything can be computed analytically. And this is the result. And okay. So for the Bulwer and Hartley-Hawking states, we can just sort of check our method and see that the results that we get, they coincide with what you obtain when you use the standard prescription, the Euclidean time prescription when you compute the Euclidean bounds. So that's how we check our method. For the Unruh state, we compute, and well, basically, so these are our results. They're in agreement with expectations. So in particular, we have this hierarchy between the exponential suppressions from the Bulwer state, from the Unruh state, and from the Hartley-Hawking state, right? So the exponential suppression is smallest, the smallest one for the Hartley-Hawking state, therefore the tunneling probability is highest for the Hartley-Hawking state, as expected. And as I said, we can compute the decay rate both near horizon and far from horizon. And when we do that, we get this hierarchy. So the decay probability near horizon is is bigger than far from horizon. This is also expected because that simply means that curve geometry by itself catalyzes vacuum decay. So the result is that the catalyzing effect is both due to geometry and due to excitations of the field. But it's important to know that it's not just, they do not act independently, the geometry and field excitations. They mix with each other. So in a non-trivial way. And this is the most important plot here. So the decay probability from the Boulevard state is almost the same as without any black hole at all. So in the Boulevard state, the catalyzing effect is really small. We don't see it at all within our analytical approximations, but we found the Boulevard bounds numerically. That's an interesting story by itself. It turns out that the Boulevard bounds, it prefers to sit exactly at this transition region between the near horizon and the symplectically flat regions. So it is sort of repelled from the black hole, but not far away. So it stays at some finite distance from the black hole. So it stays precisely the point where the near horizon region ends. And because it stays there, we cannot find it analytically, but okay, we managed to find it numerically and actually to confirm our expectation that the catalyzing effect is very mild for the Boulevard vacuum, okay, as expected, since there are no excitations.
But there is a decrease then, there's a suppression exponential.
Yeah. So all suppression, so this V0, that's just a flat space, zero temperature suppression, right? And we compare everything with this value. For the Hartley-Hawking state, we have this picture, and this lambda is temperature, proportional to temperature. For the Hartley-Hawking state, on the other hand, we have this result, that at high temperatures, the action of the solution, the decay rate becomes unsuppressed. The probability of decay becomes unsuppressed. And this is again what you expect, right? Because in the Hartley-Hawking state, you have thermal bus. So the black hole becomes very small, it becomes very hot, but the thermal bus itself becomes very hot. So here the catalyzing effect is just due to the fact that the temperature is very high, not because the black hole is very small. And this is how the exponential suppression looks like for the Unruh vacuum. So you see that it's parametrically different both from the Hartley-Hawking state and from the Boulevard state. Nevertheless, it also goes to zero at high temperatures.
Thermal corrections to the potential?
No. So this is all classical. This is all classical considerations. Yeah.
But won't they be important near the black hole when the temperatures are so big?
In principle, they could be important. They could be important if you have many degrees of freedom, like in the sonic model, for example. That's certainly important. But again, the question is. Yeah, that's certainly an interesting question, and we should compute them at some point.
Because it'll change the shape.
Yes. So it will reduce the thermal loss, which can be big, which can suppress in principle vacuum decay. Yeah, that's true. But it's not very clear how to compute this correction in the case when you don't have an actual thermal loss, right? Like in the case of Unruh vacuum, for example.
What would you do in the near the black hole, you have a thermal gap.
Almost, yeah, for modes of certain energies, yeah. But near the black holes.
But that's where your catalysis happens, right?
Not really. Not really. And this is a, yeah, okay.
Because it's mostly the boundary conditions for that.
So we compute the standalone solutions, right? And we try to identify where they're located, right? So we know, and when we compute them analytically, we just see where they're located. It turns out that, so if you talk about the Unruh vacuum, for example, it turns out that in a certain range of temperatures, the bound solution is located in the near horizon region, indeed. So the tunneling happens in the near horizon region. However, when you increase the temperature, the bound solution at some point just stops fitting this region. This is because the black hole gets smaller and smaller. And there is a certain size associated with the bound solution, which you cannot really reduce because that's just a Compton wavelength of your field and inverse mass of the field, roughly speaking. So when the size of the near horizon region or the size of the black hole becomes smaller than the inverse mass of the field, you actually cannot fit the bound solution inside that region. So the bound moves outside this region. And then the tunneling of vacuum decay, it happens really not in this region, because but it happens outside this region.
And there were no black holes at all, or because you're going to have tunneling even without the black hole, right?
Yes. So, and outside this region, curve geometry doesn't matter anymore. So, what matters are only field excitations. And that's why, for the Boulevard vacuum, for example, we have this very, very mild enhancement, because that's also something which is not obvious. I mean, I cannot understand it from the first principle, but for the Boulevard vacuum, it looks like the field sort of it is repelled. So the bounce is repelled from the horizon and it leaves somewhere outside where the curve geometry doesn't matter much. And since there are no field excitations, the decay probability is almost the same as in flat space. In the Hartley-Hawking vacuum, it is the same. At very large temperatures, your classical solution is almost like flat space phaleron. Since we work here in two dimensions, that's not the full flat space phaleron, but it's half of it. Okay. And then here in this region, the suppression is just half of that in flat space time, since the decay solution is a half of the flat space phaleron. And the same happens for the Unruh bounds. It moves outside. But when it moves outside, we cannot really find it analytically anymore. Because in this high temperature limit, the tunneling solution actually ceases to exist. And let me explain this, because that's very, like, this is also very, very generic situation. Yeah, I'm running out of time. But what happens very generally when you consider any field theory, okay, at finite temperature? Then what happens is that at small temperatures, you have a so-called periodic instanton, which describes tunneling from the state at finite temperature. However, at certain temperature, the periodic instanton doesn't, it degenerates into static solution, so-called sphaleron. And at higher temperatures, the periodic solution doesn't exist. The instanton doesn't exist. At higher temperatures, only the static sphaleron exists. And the static sphalerons describes stochastic fluctuations of the field, classical fluctuations. So in this high temperature regime, you don't have tunneling anymore. Rather, this is just classical stochastic fluctuations of the field that are dominant, that are responsible for vacuum decay. Okay. And this is a very general picture. Of course, this static solution, this phaleron, it exists at all temperatures, but at small temperatures, the tunneling dominates over stochastics, right? Because the excitations, classical excitations, field excitations, they're not energetic enough. But at high temperatures, classical field fluctuations are dominant over tunneling. And this is a very general picture. So apparently, something similar happens with the Unruh vacuum in the presence of with the Unruh bounds around, near the black hole. At small temperatures, you have a sort of periodic instanton. It's not exactly periodic because the system is not exactly in thermal equilibrium, but still it is some tunneling solution and the tunneling happens near the black hole. But at some critical temperature, the decay regime changes. The bound solution doesn't exist anymore. We cannot find it analytically. It moves outside the near horizon region and we cannot find it analytically anymore. And then we should use some other method to estimate the decay rate at high temperatures. And the method we use is just a simple stochastic estimate. So we say, okay, we kind of understand what's going on, right? The situation here is similar to what happens in thermal bath. So at high temperatures in the Unruh vacuum, we expect the decay to be mediated by classical fluctuations of the field over this phaleron. It is just that we cannot find this phaleron analytically anymore, because that's not the usual thermal phaleron, because we don't have thermal equilibrium. We have an anisotropic flux of radiation, and we cannot find analytically the associated decay solution. But you can use a simple estimate. Again, thanks to the properties of our model, we just can use this Gaussian estimate for the decay rate. So we just say that it's proportional to this phi max, where phi max is a maximum value of the field corresponding to the barrier, the potential barrier. And we divide it by the variance of the field fluctuations, which is computed in this way. So this is like the simplest possible estimate. And it makes sense here because for two reasons, right? Because first, almost any relevant field fluctuation is Gaussian, because as I said, the Talon potential, it is almost quadratic up until this instability scale. And then it quickly drops down. So for any larger fluctuation, it results in vacuum decay. And second, why we can apply this estimate? Because modes with relevant frequencies are highly populated. They have big occupation number. And that's why we can treat them as classical. And that's why we can apply this classical stochastic estimate. And when we apply it, we can recover this part of the plot. And then we can make sure that at critical temperature, where the Unruh bounds ceases to exist, we have smooth matching here between two regimes. So that's how we obtain the high temperature suppression, the Unruh bounds.
Just for curiosity, do you have any, I don't know, Hartle-Hawkins phaleron?
Of course, no, Hartle-Hawkins phaleron, we do have it. We can compute it. Analytically, we know everything about it because that's straightforward, because that situation in thermal equilibrium, okay. Right? So that's just a static Euclidean solution, right? It is known. But we don't know, strictly speaking, we don't know how the Unruh's phaleron looks like. So that's an interesting question, right? So what is a classical solution which corresponds to this decay in this moving flux of radiation? That's an interesting question. But
all the complication is coming from the fact that the vacuum is not static.
Yeah. Well, the way to proceed here, okay, I hope still I can explain it, like 2 minutes. Just very quickly. So what's the difference between our toy two-dimensional model and realistic system in four dimensions, right? So what was neglected so far? Two things. In four dimensions, we can also compute this effective potential for linear massive modes, spherical symmetric modes. And we find that, there are two things, right? The first thing is that there is centrifugal barrier for these modes, which doesn't exist in two dimensions. And this is it. So when we compute the effective potential, there is this additional contribution. And the second thing is that in four dimensions, there is an area growth, right? And because of that, the flux of Hawking radiation, it gets diluted, right? When radiation flies away from the black hole. Actually, both these things are expected to further reduce the probability of decay of the Unruh vacuum. But it's important to make real computation here as well. And it turns out that it is actually straightforward to take into account the correction provided by the centrifugal barrier. Again, we can model this barrier in our two-dimensional model. So this is how the effective potential becomes modified, right? So this is a potential that we considered so far. And this is a sort of realistic four-dimensional effective potential for linear field perturbations. And now we want to add this barrier, the temperature-dependent barrier, in our toy model and see how the results are changed. So this is the second paper. And actually it turns out that it's very simple to model this barrier. One should add this interaction term in our toy model. So the interaction between the scalar field phi and the so-called dilaton field that constitutes a dilaton black hole background. Okay, so there is a metric and there is a dilaton field in two dimensions. And we introduce this coupling. And we arrive at this expression for the effective potential. Only, of course, in our case, omega is still given by the dilaton black hole background. So this omega is not the same as the omega in Schwarzschild background, but this doesn't matter. So this is the effect that we want to take into account. And now, again, long story short, this is how our results are changed. So it turns out that they changed drastically. Again, the situation is that at low temperatures, vacuum decay proceeds via tunneling via the Unruh bounds, and it happens in the black hole vicinity, in the near horizon region. At large temperatures, the Unruh bounds doesn't exist, and the vacuum decay proceeds via stochastic jumps onto the sphaleron, but not thermal sphaleron, but the Unruh sphaleron. And it happens, these jumps happen in the outer region, in the asymptotically flat region. But in that region, this barrier, it actually reduces the flux of Hawking radiation, right? It reduces the flux significantly. So there are much less excitations here than without this barrier, especially at high temperatures, because the barrier becomes high. And because of that, we actually have this behavior of the exponential suppression. So instead of going to zero, thanks to this temperature-dependent barrier that reduces the flux of Hawking radiation in the outer region, we now see that the exponential suppression tends to constant. So in other words, the decay of the Unruh vacuum at high temperatures, it goes to constant. So the decay of the Unruh vacuum remains exponentially suppressed at all temperatures in this model with a barrier. That's the main result. And then it is more or less clear that the same is going to happen in four dimensions. Moreover, in four dimensions, it's going to be even worse than that, because in four dimensions, you also have the area growth. And because of this area growth, you expect to have further reduction of this decay rate. So my expectation is that instead of staying constant in high temperatures, it will start growing again. And there will be some optimal temperature at which the catalyzing effect is the biggest one. And the general expectation is that this temperature is of the order of the mass of the field. So that's what I can say so far. And okay, outlook, that's it's important to compute the prefactor. It's important, as we discussed, to compute thermal corrections. It's important to be more systematic about this classical stochastic approach, to, you know, to generalize it and to make actual computation of classical stochastic dynamics, to put the system on a lattice and actually observe how this Unruh sphaleron appears, because we didn't manage to find it analytically. Then we should find it numerically and see how it looks like. That's very interesting. Yeah, and then of course, the most ambitious goal is to take into account back reaction of Talon fields onto gravity and to see how this changes the result. Because as I said, this may open window into other puzzles of black hole physics, such as black hole entropy information paradox. Yeah, okay, that's it. Thank you. Yeah.
So what's the connection to the information
diagram? That's super speculative. But you see, it may happen that, so when you take into account back reaction on gravity, in principle, the mass of the black hole after tunneling, right? It can change. It may change, right? So then in principle, it could even be that it disappears completely, right? After tunneling. And if it disappears completely, then you kind of have here a similar process, right? So you have the initial state with a black hole, and you have a final state after tunneling without the black hole. And this is not exactly black hole evaporation, right? That's something completely different, but it's kind of also the process in which the black hole disappears in this process, right?
Because normally it's formulated as throwing things into the black hole.
Yeah. But then the paradox appears after the black hole evaporates, right? Because after it evaporates, you have mixed state, you have thermal equilibrium, and you don't recover any information, anyway, thrown into the black hole, right? Mm-hmm. And here, but again, that's just, I don't have anything more to say about it. This is just very naive expectation that it may somehow be related.
Sorry, just to understand that this barrier in this where does this barrier come from?
It's a centrifugal barrier. What barrier?
Okay, it's a centrifugal barrier for the black hole, right?
Yeah. So you just take that's simple. I mean,
But then you affect that to the scalar potential, right? Which is the vacuum decay.
Yeah. So this is just your theory, right? Mm-hmm. So now the point is to introduce smart coordinates in which you can see everything immediately. Mm-hmm. And okay, so you should redefine somehow your variables, but after you redefine your variables, the point is to make the theory as similar to the two-dimensional model as possible, right? To see the difference. And then when you do that, you see that, okay, so you introduce coordinates, tau x and so on. So this is dx d tau. There is a usual kinetic term. The field is different now. And you have here m squared omega, and you have an additional term, which comes from the fact that here you have r squared, which you don't have in two dimensions. So because of that, it gives you this additional term, the centrifugal barrier, chi squared. Plus you also have some, if there is chi to the fourth, for example, there will be also r to the fourth here and so on. So this is like the area growth, which dumps the potential at large distances. But this is a centrifugal barrier. And when you study linear theory, linear modes, this is the effective potential for the Schrödinger equation for these modes. And then this is, yeah. Then this is just this barrier.
So I think in the Fourier case that we do have this kind of potential just from the Klein-Gordon equation, you want to limit that in 2D, right?
Yeah, exactly. So that's what you have in 4D, and now you want to mimic that in 2D. Okay. And so you have to reproduce somehow this term in 2D, and it turns out that it's very simple. You just add some interaction with the Dilaton field, and you get precisely this term. But R here is fixed. It's fixed by the Schwarzschild radius. So area growth is still not accounted for, and omega is different, but qualitatively you reproduce the behavior.
And your calculation for the non-suppressed, Hartle-Hawking black hole configuration still catalyzes the phase transition.
Yeah, because that state in thermal equilibrium and with or without the barrier, it's gonna catalyze vacuum decay. Well, I can say much more about this, of course, but okay, so the result is that the barrier changes the Hartle-Hawking vacuum as well. So without the barrier, the high temperatures Phaleron, okay, so this is like, so this is a near horizon region and this is an exotically flat region. So without the barrier at high temperatures, your solution in the Hartle-Hawking state, it looks like this. So here it is flat space Phaleron and here it's just constant. This part doesn't contribute because, I mean, the size of the region is very small. So this is just half of, and this is purely geometric effect in two dimensions. So there is really no effect from curved geometry here. Now, when you add the barrier, at high temperatures, it becomes very high, right? So it becomes like a delta function. So apparently you cannot have the solution anymore. Something must happen with it. So it turns out that at high temperatures, this barrier, it repels this Phaleron. So it moves outside, it develops kind of, it becomes like this, then it becomes like this, then it becomes like this, and it constantly moves away from the barrier. And at some finer temperature, it actually stops existing at all. So it moves all the way to infinity, and at sufficiently high temperatures, the decay rate is exactly the same as in flat space. So that's a peculiarity again of our two-dimensional model, but this matches the four-dimensional picture because in four dimensions at very high temperatures, you just don't, you're not sensitive to the black hole because it's too small, right? So your vacuum decay proceeds as in flat space time. So the effect of curved geometry is completely negligible. And this two-dimensional model with a barrier, it nicely reproduces this property, which kind of gives us one more argument that the UNRU, the picture for the UNRU vacuum is also reasonable.
Wait, just to make sure, so in the high temperature, you're saying that the standard is going away from the horizon, but I guess the, if you take high temperature, it's actually the horizon is shrinking, right? So which one is correct, like the, you know, if you fix the mass scale of your scale here, then is this instanton going away or is this the horizon shrinking?
Of course, that's horizon shrinking, right? These are just coordinates. These are just taught to us coordinates, which are not physical coordinates, right? So in physical coordinates, of course, this is a horizon shrinking. And
the position of the instanton is almost constant and the horizon is shrinking.
Yeah.
And then because there is a high, there is a this barrier.
Yeah, but you see, again, since that's two dimensions, you cannot really make, in four dimensions, you can compute, again, you can compute this further on numerically. That's not difficult because that's just, this is a static solution. And even if it's not static, again, you know how to compute it. So it's not difficult. And if you rewrite everything in this coordinate, in this peculiar coordinates, even in four dimensions, you will see this behavior. That kind of, it stays constant here in the near horizon region, but the constant goes to zero asymptotically. And, but in the physical coordinates, of course, this is just the flat space phaleron, which is around the black hole, which is just very small.
Maybe some people from the Zoom can ask.
Are there people
it's
on
not
Zoom?
Muted, so if anyone speak, they should be able to hear. OK, good. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Andrew.
Very nice.